welcome. You're watching WION's special broadcast for the Karnataka elections. Crime and money continues to play a big role in Indian politics, as we know, no matter which part of the country. Now, whether it becomes a matter of debate or not, it certainly does exist in public life. Not only has big money wriggled into the political area, but also candidates with criminal records, and some very serious criminal records, we must say, have become routine. Now, the recent ADR, which is Association for Democratic Reforms report, shows that political parties are almost immune to the issue of money and criminal records. Candidates who flush in the money are given tickets despite their criminal records and are generously accommodated by the political parties in Karnataka. So hello and welcome. I'm Nishtita Virendra and this is Karnataka Votes. Well, first up, let's take a quick look at how the ticket distribution looks like in Karnataka this time around if we take into consideration the criminal records of these candidates. Well, as of now, if you look at the Congress party's candidates, 32% of the candidates fielded by the Congress have criminal cases against them. Whereas in BJP as well as the JDS, the other two major parties of the state, 27% of the candidates in these two parties have criminal records registered against them. But these criminal records also include some very serious criminal charges. Now, ADR, while carrying out its survey, ensured that they took into consideration only those candidates whose criminal records are such that if convicted, they can be jailed for at least 5 years. So now let's take a look at how many candidates have cases of serious nature pending against them. 17% of the candidates fielded by the BJP have serious criminal cases. For the Congress and JDS, the number stands at a little less, which is at 16%. Now, these criminal records and cases also include crimes against women and something that they can be jailed for if they are convicted. So earlier, WION spoke to Trilochan Shastri, who is the man who heads ADR, who is the chairman of ADR, and who has been fighting for democratic reforms, not just in Karnataka, but across the country. He's also the former dean of Indian Institute of Management, Bengaluru. Let's listen into what he had to say. Well, according to the data from the Association for Democratic Reforms, nearly 33% of the recontesting candidates have criminal cases registered against them. Joining me today is the chairman as well as the founder of ADR, Mr. Trilochan Shastri. Mr. Shastri, first of all, if you can break down the figures to us as to what does it really look like? How many of these candidates have criminal cases registered against them and how many are serious criminal cases?
That's right. So, you know, let me first qualify this data. This is about the past data that they had filed in the previous elections. And we are looking at recontesting candidates who are... So from that data, the figure that you have put out is accurate. It's about 30 to 33%. It varies from between the three major parties, the Congress, the BJP and the JDS. So all of them are in excess of 27% of people with criminal cases. So these are cases which are, you know, if they're convicted, they would be actually not allowed to stand for elections. And if we dig deeper, we find that there are some people with what we call serious criminal cases. So that's about 19%. 19% of the recontesting candidates have serious criminal cases, which if they were convicted would send them to jail for at least 5 years. So our question to the political parties is very simple. Why do you persist in giving tickets to such people?
Right, absolutely. And also, what kind of criminal cases are we talking about here, especially the serious criminal cases?
Yeah, so we have crimes against women, which is much in the news today. We have murder and attempt to murder cases. We have financial fraud cases of various types and so on. And, you know, some violent crimes which don't amount to murder, abetment to murder and so on. So these kind of cases are serious. And we certainly don't want to see such people contesting elections till they're cleared by a court of law.
And while both Congress and the BJP have different views on this issue. Many argue that political cases are different from criminal cases, and that was the justification that was given to us when we approached Rajya Sabha MP Mr. Rajiv Gowda. But the fact of the matter is that when it comes to ticket distribution, only amiability counts in politics, and Karnataka has been no different, with all the parties going only for what they term are winnable candidates, irrespective of their background.
Many cases which are criminal in nature are cases involving political activity, and so you will find even Aam Aadmi Party candidates who also speak about fighting corruption, you will find criminal cases against them. There are lots of movements that take place when you take part in a rally violating prohibitory orders, then someone will file, the authorities file criminal cases. So these sorts of charges do occur. We have to sift those cases which are of a particular nature from the routine criminal cases which are which arise in the context of democratic activity. Clean governance is something that the Congress has already delivered in Karnataka, so it is taken for granted. Clean governance is something that Siddaramaiah has stood for. There have been no corruption scandals against us during these 5 years, compared to, if you look at the track record of the previous BJP government, the entire list of the BJP consists of, if you go to a police station and look for wanted, all these people, you will see all these people's photos there. There are a whole bunch of jailbirds in the BJP's list. This question about fielding tainted leaders, you should ask the BJP, starting with Yediyurappa. You have the Reddy brothers, you have Sri Ramalu, you have Katta Subramanian Naidu, you have Halappa, there's such a long list, we will take half an hour going through the list of corrupt and criminal candidates fielded by the BJP. The people of Karnataka will reject them soundly. We do not want to be ruled. We want by corrupt and criminal elements. We want a clean governance, and that is what the Congress has delivered, will continue to deliver.
Well, the blame game continues between the Congress and the BJP, but the fact of the matter is that money has been freely flowing, not just ahead of elections, but well before that. Last year, during the Nanjangud Gundlupet by-elections, the Election Commission had to triple its budget by 3 times to ensure that it can curtail the candidates using the money, and we know that a lot of money had been spent. Similar cases came to light in the RK Nagar elections as well in neighbouring Tamil Nadu. So as we know, money speaks, and those candidates who have abundant reserves have a free way in the state of Karnataka. And statistics are also here to prove that if you have money, any party will readily hand you a ticket. Let's take a look at a few of these statistics. 91% of Karnataka's Congress candidates are millionaire. Now, that number is a little lower for the BJP at 82%. And when it comes to the JDS, it does slightly better at 79%. So the average wealth of the recontesting candidates of all these parties, clearly we can say that money rules the roost. Now the average wealth of a recontesting candidate of Congress is 28 crore rupees, and that is the average wealth. For the BJP, the figure stands at 8 crores, and for the JDS, it's an average wealth of around 14 crore rupees. Well, that was how the political parties fared. Now, let's take a look at some of the candidates themselves who have seen an exponential rise in their assets in the last 5 years, particularly who are in the sitting Congress government. The case in point being that of Energy Minister of Karnataka, D.K. Shivakumar. As we know, D.K. Shivakumar also faced IT raids last year. And he has filed an affidavit where he has said that his accountable assets are worth a whopping 618 crore rupees, which is a 300% jump from his election affidavit of 2013, where he declared assets worth 215 crore rupees. And mind you, these are just declared assets. Now, the list certainly does not end at that, as we know. When we go to the mining hub of the state, which is Ballari, which was in the news for all the wrong reasons between 2008 and 2013, the leaders here are not far behind and have seen a substantial increase in their fortunes as well. Case in point being that of Anand Singh, who made the shift from BJP to the Congress recently, has declared assets worth 117 crore rupees. And the number of cases registered against him have also seen an exponential rise. While it was 1 in 2013, it's gone up to 16 in 2018. JDS candidate Muhammad Iqbal Puttur is also one such case, who has two illegal mining cases against him but has declared assets worth a whopping 380 crore rupees. Let's take a look at figures from opposition leaders as well. Opposition leader as well as chief ministerial candidate for the BJP, B.S. Yediyurappa, has seen a 12% increase in his assets, which stand at 6.5 crore rupees. But if you compare it to his assets increase from 2008 to 2013 when BJP was in power, back then the rise in his assets was a whopping 500%. So clearly there seems to be a direct correlation between leaders who are in power and the leaders who are in the opposition.
Isn't it a conspiratorial coincidence that Shri Amit Shah declared Shri B.S. Yediyurappa as the Chief Minister face on 27th of May 2017 and CBI closed the illegal mining cases on 13th June 2017 and 8th November 2017 within 17 and 165 days?
None of these parties, mainstream parties, are different, any different. Earlier in the last assembly elections, Mr. Siddaramaiah had marched to Ballari saying that he had done a padyatra saying opposing illegal mining. Very same Siddaramaiah has gone and inducted the criminals who had gone to the jails on criminal charges, Mr. Anand Singh, then B. Nagendra and various other people, and Mr. Ashok Keni, who was facing serious charges in terms of corruptions. They have gone and inducted them. So where is the sanctity for their claim to clean and clean government? There is nothing. And BJP is projecting Mr. Yediyurappa, who had gone on charges of corruption, and he is still facing several charges which are pending in the court, and they are making him as a CM candidate. They have announced much before Congress, and so there is no difference at all. So even in the case of JDS, there are many criminals. The ADR report says so. So none of them can claim any sanctity to their candidatures, nothing.
And well, speaking of tainted candidates, the entire Reddy Brothers posse seems to be back in the BJP mainstream. Now, once responsible for literally destabilizing the BJP government in the state and causing immense amount of embarrassment to the state of Karnataka itself, now two of the Reddy Brothers are contesting elections on the BJP ticket. Not just that, Janardhan Reddy, who was believed to be the kingpin of all, although is not contesting, is remote controlling the entire campaign sitting in neighboring Chitradurga. Not just in Chitradurga, in fact today he was also in Bengaluru canvassing for one of his relatives in the BTM layout constituency. Although the BJP has tried to distance itself from Janardhan Reddy with Amit Shah last month, going on to say that BJP has nothing to do with Janardhan Reddy, but Janardhan Reddy is out there on field making statements like BJP is in his blood. He is sharing dais with B.S. Yediyurappa, who is the chief ministerial candidate, along with Shivraj Singh Chauhan, who is the Madhya Pradesh chief minister, and is actively seen participating in the activities.
The facts about illegal mining are very, very widely known among the general public, the local population, the population of the district. It's a well-known fact. The people involved in illegal mining are also very, very well identified. Even before the CBI made its arrests or made their investigations or filed the charge sheet, it was already known in the public domain who are the people, parties involved in illegal mining, who are their, who is aiding and abetting them, who are their political, masters. Everything is well known to the public. Now, unfortunately, it's a distortion of our criminal justice system. And most regrettably, the rampant corruption in the lower judiciary, that the CBI has given clean chits to some of the accused. And while the subordinate officers and the investigating officers of the CBI are extremely competent, very honest individuals, their political bosses who direct the course of the prosecution, they have let the country down very badly. To give you an example, Yediyurappa got a clean chit, Mrs. Janardhan Reddy got a clean chit, but the CBI has not appealed against their acquittal.
BJP will have nothing to do with the Janardhan Reddy. Now today he's sharing stage with BS Yediyurappa. He's campaigning for your BTM layout constituency candidate. So is Janardhan Reddy back in the BJP? Is he taking mainstream politics with the Bharatiya Janata Party?
When our national president Shri Amit Shah has said we have nothing to do with the Janardhan Reddy, and that is final. If somebody campaigns for the Bharatiya Janata Party candidates on their own, that we are not responsible for that. On their own personal relationship, he must be campaigning for them.
But he is telling that BJP is in his blood. And even if he's campaigning out of his own wish and it's not official, aren't you risking BJP's image because you're fighting the elections on the plank of corruption and scams and accusing the Siddaramaiah government of it?
He has not been given ticket. He has not been admitted into the party. He individually is campaigning. He says BJP is in blood means can I remove that blood from him? That's not possible. That is his prerogative. BJP has not invited him to campaign for the party or the candidates.
Okay.
It's very clear.
But this news that he is remote controlling the campaign is sitting in Molakalmuru?
See, these are all the assumptions made by the vested interest. Campaigning cannot be remote controlled. It can only be organized sitting in the particular constituencies. Just to sensationalize his presence in election campaign, many stories are floated. Please don't take them on its face value.
Though the Congress has been critical of the BJP, accusing it of encouraging corruption, the BJP rejects to have found a place in the grand old party. Now, Anand Singh and B. Nagendra, who were both arrested by the CBI on illegal mining charges and were released on bail, have got a Congress ticket. So clearly, neither of the parties can claim to be holier than thou. Now, the assurances on corruption and criminality are mere grandstanding gestures by all political parties alike, be it advertising or election speeches. But when it comes to elections, the only criteria that really matters, it seems, is the candidate's ability to win, by hook or by crook. Well, with that, we wrap this edition of Karnataka Votes, but we'll be back with more issues at the center of Karnataka elections at 8:30 p.m. tomorrow. For now, slipping into a short break, Aisha Sindhu will be back with more on the other side.